a public service announcement with guitar!
Rather, with drums. Hello, and welcome to FBBC Documentaries. I am Elena Chute, and I will be your host for this evening. Today, FBBC Documentaries brings you the facts on heroin and the tale of how it and other drugs completely destroyed rock drummer Topper Headon's life.
I used to get fear, excitement, and anxiety all mixed up. Now, a lot of times I'd be excited about something, but I think, well, I'm scared, or I'd never got those things sorted. And I never dealt with those feelings, and I started using drugs, you know, and that hampered everything and kind of ruined my life.
You're too messed up, man.
Drug made from morphine, which is derived from the opium poppy. It can be snorted, smoked, and injected. Some slang terms for heroin include dope, smack, skag, tar, and chunk. In addition to the euphoria it produces, it also has the short-term effects of a dry mouth, flushing, clouded mental functions, and the state of going back and forth between consciousness and semi-consciousness. Its long-term effects are much scarier. These can include collapsed veins, infections of the heart lining, abscesses, liver and kidney disease, and lung complications. In addition to these, users who inject are at risk for diseases such as hepatitis and HIV. However, this program is not about the effects of heroin on one's body, so much as just about the effects of heroin dependency on a person's life. We will now turn to Owen Chute at our Glasgow studio for the nightly business report, and then take a break for a word from our sponsor.
Dow Jones gained 143 points to close in near 20,412. The NASDAQ added 30 points for a total of 5,764, and the S&P 500 gained 12 to close at 2,328.
Nicholas Bowen Headon was born in Crockenhill, England, on May 30, 1955, to Philip and Margaret Headon. He attended Dover Grammar School for Boys, where his father was the headmaster. When he was a child, he saw Keith Moon of The Who on Top of the Pops, and that was when he first realized that he liked the drums. At the age of 13, Headon broke his leg playing soccer. After his doctor suggested that he take up some sort of hobby, Headon's father bought him his first drum kit, and it soon became an obsession.
All day long, all evening long, every hour I could get a weekend, because it was like my first addiction, really drumming.
When he was a young man, he married his first wife, Wendy, and they moved to London together, where he got odd jobs playing with jazz and funk groups. Meanwhile, in 1976, in a squat in Camden Town, a group of angry young men had gotten their own band together. Originally called the Weak Heart Drops, this band would soon come to be known as The Clash and would be influential in the explosion of punk rock in the UK.
All across the night, everybody's driving with four headlights. Black or white, you turn it on your face and the religion.
This first lineup featured Joe Strummer as the lead singer and rhythm guitarist, Mick Jones as the lead guitarist, Keith Levine as the third guitarist, Paul Simonon on bass, and Terry Chimes on drums. Levine was soon kicked out of the band for his drug problems, and Chimes was later fired for being unreliable. For some time, The Clash continued on with various different drummers. In 1977, they signed a contract with CBS Records and temporarily got Chimes back to play on their debut album, The Clash. After that, they put an ad in the newspaper in an attempt to find a drummer to play with them on their White Riot tour. After 206 drummers, they found Nick Headon.
So the next day I went back and they, you know, they cut my hair off and Paul cut it off. They all dyed it and it came out an orange. And Paul by now was reading the copy of the Topper. He went, "You look like Mickey the Monkey, we call you Topper." And at the time I was kind of mortified. I thought, what?
They called him Topper because of his resemblance to a character in a comic named The Topper, and he started his career as a rock star on the White Riot Tour. On the road, he discovered the hard-partying lifestyle which accompanied rock and roll in the 70s. Coke and booze were what were done, and he took to them with zeal.
And I remember, you know, I used to love touring. I was only happy when we were touring.
Yeah.
But the others used to find it quite tiring. You know, yeah. It's just the way it was. I love being on the road because it was one big party.
Yeah.
You know, as you know, I got into trouble because it was one big party, but that's my personality. You know, I like parties. Yeah. Oh, I used to like parties, and it was great to be on tour because that was a 30-day party. Yeah.
He soon divorced his wife after having to deny that he was married in order to get the job as drummer. The Clash's second album was the first studio album he ever recorded, entitled Give Him Enough Rope, on which the producer gave him the nickname The Human Drum Machine. On the road, he became a bit of an alcoholic. It was Mick Jones who first introduced him to cocaine, and soon that dominated his life. Eventually, he was snorting cocaine on stage between songs to fuel his playing. But generally, in the early years of The Clash, he only got in trouble off tour for pulling minor bad boy stunts, such as the time that he and Simonon shot racing pigeons out of an apartment window with air guns. However, it was between tours around 1980 when he first tried heroin. By this time, The Clash was recording their fourth album, Sandinista, and he was becoming an addict. In December of 1981, he was busted at the Heathrow Airport for attempting to smuggle heroin into the UK. From the United States. As Headon's life spiraled downwards, The Clash skyrocketed upwards in 1982 with the emergence of their fifth album, Combat Rock, and their chart-topping hit, Rock the Casbah, written by none other than Headon himself. Unfortunately, the other members of the band were fed up with the drummer's self-destructive behavior.
What he was up to sort of made a sort of mockery of what the group was about and what Joe was writing about.
He was saying, how can I write all these songs about anti-drugs when you're standing out of your head behind me, you know? Junkie Dumb USA, where procaine proves the purest rock man groove
and rat poison, the volatile Molotov says. At the same time, Strummer and Jones were no longer on speaking terms. But despite this, The Clash continued to function as a unit and look out for each other, even though they were furious with the other members of the group. Ignorance ruled the day, as none of them knew anything about heroin or how to help their friend, who was so obviously headed for trouble. On May 10th, 1982, Strummer, sick and tired of Headon's addiction, sacked him from The Clash and replaced him with their old drummer, Terry Chimes, for their upcoming tour of the U.S. It was only after Headon was sacked from The Clash that he first injected heroin.
I gotta go sunbathing.
See you.
You go sunbathing.
Bye, Topper. Down the railway track. Keep going. He's gone.
Pete Townsend, a member of The Who, paid for Headon to undergo rehabilitation in Los Angeles. Unfortunately, the hospital he stayed at was just down the street from a music festival from which he could hear The Clash playing without him. He also saw the music video for Rock the Casbah, in which his band was playing his song with another drummer at his kick. Headon attempted to get another band together with guitarist and fellow heroin addict Rob Stoner from Bob Dylan's band and bassist and heroin junkie Pete Farndon of The Pretenders. However, in April of 1983, Farndon died of an overdose. But Headon's leaving the group signaled the beginning of the end for The Clash. Mick Jones had become too difficult for Strummer to work with, and a year after Headon went, Jones got the boot as well.
And I feel a lot of guilt about that, you know, because if I'd have kept my act together, I could see the band, you know, possibly still being together today in a way. I'd like to kind of apologise to them for kind of letting the side down. They're going off the rails, but I think if it happened again, I'd probably do the same thing. I'm just that sort of person, you know.
Jones started another band, Big Audio Dynamite, and offered the position of drummer to Headon if he got clean. But one night after rehearsal, Jones made the mistake of telling him how much they were about to make in Clash royalties, a sum equivalent to over $900,000 today. And he decided there was no point in trying to get clean and left. Jones went on to have success in Big Audio Dynamite with another drummer. As for Headon, the money lasted him 18 months, and then he went broke. In 1986, he released his solo album, Waking Up, as well as an EP and several singles in a last-ditch effort to finance his drug habit. As for The Clash, Chimes eventually left, and Simonon and Strummer were left to carry on with three different guys. In 1985, they released their final album, Cut the Crap, and in early 1986, they officially disbanded. Strummer blamed himself for the breakup of the band, saying they never played a good gig after Topper left.
Even rock and roll was uncool.
In February of 1987, Headon and his girlfriend, Catherine Belbin, were charged with supplying heroin to a man named Barry Waller, who later died of an overdose. Between then and their trial in November, he and Belbin got married. At their trial, Belbin was sentenced to 3 months in prison for possession and Headon 15 months for supply. While he was in prison, they divorced. After he was released, Headon bribed officials at a taxi company in London to let him work there. With his music career behind him, he became a minicab driver to support his addiction, until eventually he ended up homeless and broke at the St. Mungo's Hostel for the Homeless. Around the turn of the century, weighing only 105 pounds, he was involved in a car crash in which he ruptured his spleen, crushed his ribs, punctured a lung, and suffered a severe head injury. After this, he returned to his hometown of Dover, England, and moved in with his parents while he completed rehab. It was the 13th time he had been through rehab. Somehow, he managed to get clean this time. During the 80s, he had contracted hepatitis C, and so a year afterwards, he went through treatment for that as well.
I got hepatitis C through injecting heroin, and I didn't bother trying to, I knew I had hepatitis C for a long time, but there didn't seem to be any point sorting out the virus until I was clean, and when I was a year clean, I started to feel tired all the time, so I decided to do the treatment, and it was hell. It was really tough, but it was well worth it.
In 2002, at the age of 50, The Clash's frontman, Joe Strummer, died of a hereditary heart defect, and it hit Headon, who had just managed to clean up his life, hard.
My first thought when I heard Joe was dying was, that should have been me. You know, if anyone in The Clash was going to die a premature death, that should have been me. I was lucky enough to see him. He played at the Shepherd's Bush Empire a couple of months before his death. You know, it was great to go and see him. The sad thing is that when I went backstage, he said, "What's that you're drinking?" And it was beer. And he knows I'm an alcoholic. I really wish that the last time he'd seen me, I would have been, that's a Coke, you know? That's kind of my one regret.
Headon has started a Narcotics Anonymous group as well as a hepatitis C support group in Dover and has started listening to music and playing drums again, both for fun and for its therapeutic qualities, of which he is a strong believer in. In 2013, he also worked with Mick Jones and Paul Simonon to put together a complete compilation of everything the original trio with Headon and Chimes ever recorded. He is happy, healthy, and content living in his hometown of Dover, doing charity work and playing the drums for fun.
So long, I forgot what it's like to be really healthy and to have normal energy levels, and I feel amazing. For a start, I was using, then I got clean. The whole of my clean time was spent with a liver that was practically not working. So now, it's the first time in my life I've been clean and I have a healthy liver. And I feel a lot younger than I look.
But definitely, overall, if I had a choice, it would be to do everything clean.
I search through the drinker, propped over his claw.
the FBBC documentary for tonight. I hope to see you again next time on FBBC's Casualties of Rock and Roll. Good night, and of course, God save the Queen. Next week on Casualties of Rock and Roll, FBBC Documentaries presents Your Brains Are Locked Away, the story of Sid Vicious.